Welcome to the tutorial Thermal Infrared Remote Sensing Principles and Applications. My name is Juan Carlos Jiménez Muñoz. I'm an assistant professor at the Department of Earth Physics and Thermodynamics at the University of Valencia. Here you can find my contact details in case you have any questions about this tutorial. This tutorial has been created with the collaboration of José Antonio Sobrino, full professor, Raquel Niclós, a research associate, and Vicente Caselles, full professor. They also belong to the Department of Earth Physics and Thermodynamics at the University of Valencia. The main objective of this tutorial is to provide a general overview of thermal remote sensing. To this aim, we have organized the tutorial in two parts. The first part, we will talk about the basic concepts or more theoretical concepts related to thermal remote sensing. And in the second part, we will show some examples or applications and case studies in which we used thermal imagery. Well, as a kind of introduction, we can say that less attention has been given to thermal remote sensing, at least in comparison with other spectral ranges, for example, the visible and near infrared. However, thermal remote sensing is necessary for a better understanding of land surface processes and land atmosphere interactions. For example, most of the fluxes at this interface can only be parameterized through the use of thermal data. The main variables to be retrieved when working with thermal data are land surface temperature and land surface emissivity. Emissivity is a spectral magnitude, so it will depend on the wavelength or sensor band, whereas the land surface temperature is not dependent on the wavelength or sensor band. We will talk in the second part of the tutorial about the different applications, but in general terms we can say that surface temperature can be used in climatology, in the analysis of land cover change, in oceanography using sea surface temperature, and also for studies related to energy balance, for example for the retrieval of heat fluxes or evapotranspiration, which is a key variable in water management. The surface emissivity is also an important variable. It is required to obtain accurate values of land surface temperature, but it provides useful information by itself, especially in geology, for example, for mineral mapping through the identification of different minerals using or by analyzing the characteristic spectral features of the emissivity spectrum. Well, this table shows a kind of summary of the basic spectral regions used in optical remote sensing. This is just to remark that in this tutorial we will focus on the thermal infrared region approximately between 8 and 14 or 15 microns. There is also another region, which is the mid-infrared, between 3 to 5 approximately microns, in which we have also thermal emission added to the solar reflection. This region is also very interesting and provides useful information and can be also used to obtain surface temperature and emissivity. But, as I have said before, we will focus in this tutorial only in the thermal infrared region. Well, this slide shows a basic pre-processing scheme for thermal infrared data, and we also show the pre-processing or the main steps of the solar in the solar region, just for comparison with the thermal region. In the case of the solar range, from at sensor data, and after the radiometric calibration, we can obtain the top of atmosphere reflectance. If we perform an atmospheric correction, then we can recover the at surface reflectance and use this reflectance for different applications. Well, in the case of the thermal part, thermal region, from at sensor data and after the radiometric calibration, we can obtain what we call the brightness temperature, which is also at top of atmosphere level. After the atmospheric correction, we can recover the land surface temperature and land surface emissivity. And then we can use these two variables to perform or for the analysis of a given application. Of course, this is a simplified scheme. We need to take into account other general corrections, for example, noise removal or the cloud screening, in which thermal data is also very useful, or other corrections, geometric, angular, or illumination corrections. This table provides a summary of the basic radiometric magnitudes. We are not going into details of these magnitudes. This is just to remark that the important or the main variable is the spectral radiance, which is the energy by unit area for a given view angle and for a given wavelength. The three basic laws of radiation are the Planck's law, Stefan-Boltzmann law, and Wien's displacement law. Planck's law provides a mathematical expression for the spectral distribution of the radiance emitted by a black body. This is the mathematical equation, and we can invert this expression to obtain temperature from radiance. This equation is very useful in thermal infrared, thermal remote sensing, because we can obtain brightness temperature from the radiance measured by the sensor. The Stefan-Boltzmann law provides the total emissive power of a black body, so it not depends on the wavelength, and it does not provide the spectral distribution, but the integrated value for all the wavelengths. This is the expression for the Stefan-Boltzmann law, or we can include this P factor if we want to obtain the total emissive power for a given direction, assuming we have a Lambertian surface. Well, the spectral distribution of the radiance for a black body, according to the Planck's law, shows a peak in a given wavelength. Well, the radiant energy peak is defined as the wavelength at which the maximum amount of energy is radiated. As temperature increases, this radiant energy peak shifts to shorter wavelengths. This shift is described by the Wien's displacement law, which is here, in which the wavelength and or the wavelength for which the radiant energy peak occurs multiplied by temperature is always a constant. Well, this is illustrated here in this graph, in which we show the spectral radiance for different wavelengths. This is just the Planck's law for different temperatures. We can observe this maximum peak here, and we can see also that this peak moves to longer wavelengths when the temperature decreases. For example, if we apply the Wien's displacement law for a temperature of the Sun, approximately 6000 Kelvin, we can obtain that this peak is located at a wavelength of around 0.5 microns, which is located in the visible region. If we do the same for the case of the Earth temperature, approximately 300 Kelvin, then the wavelength is around 9.7 microns, which is located in the thermal infrared region. Well, despite that the Planck's law provides the spectral distribution for any wavelength, it is common to use different approaches to the Planck's law, depending on the wavelength region. For example, for short wavelengths, we can use the Wien approach, which is expressed here, and for long wavelengths, we can use the Rayleigh-Jeans approach, which is expressed here. This is a common approach, for example, when working with microwaves. In any case, we can use the Planck's law to describe all the spectral distribution for any wavelength. Well, a black body is a theoretical material that absorbs all the radiant energy. This means that the absorptivity is equal to 1, 100%. But it also radiates all of its energy in a wavelength distribution pattern that is dependent only on the temperature. That's the Planck's law that we have seen before. Well, then, the black body is a theoretical material, so it is not real. For real materials, we need to introduce a property called emissivity, which is defined as the ratio between the real radiant flux and the radiant flux from a black body. It is a spectral magnitude, and it measures the effectiveness in emitting energy as thermal radiation. Therefore, for a black body, the emissivity is always equal 1, but for real materials, including natural surfaces, the emissivity will be always lower than 1. This implies that the radiation laws need to be corrected for this emissivity factor. Well, another important law is the Kirchhoff law, according to which, for a given wavelength, the absorptivity of the surface equals the emissivity of the surface at the same temperature. This is a fundamental approach in radiometry because emissivity values can be obtained from reflectivity measurements using this simple expression here. Well, surface emissivity is then a key variable in thermal remote sensing because accurate retrievals of surface temperature rely on an accurate estimation of surface emissivity. We have seen before that the radiation laws, or the Planck's law in particular, needs to be corrected for the emissivity factor. Also, the emissivity spectra provides useful information. Here we saw just some examples of emissivity spectra for different surfaces. These emissivity spectra have been extracted from spectral libraries, which include different emissivity spectra for a number of different surfaces measured in the laboratory. Different spectral libraries exist, but maybe the most used are the MODIS and ASTER spectral libraries, which can be obtained here in these two links. Well, in the case of rocks, we provide here the emissivity spectra for quartz, diorite, basalt, and marble. We can see that there is a very high spectral variation in emissivity for rocks. For example, in the case of quartz, we can obtain a very low value, around 0.8 for this wavelength range here. We can observe also this characteristic spectral feature here in the range between 8 and 9 microns. And we can obtain, for example, for other wavelengths, pues, values near to 1. In the case of marble, we can observe also a very characteristic peak here near the 11 microns. For the case of water or green vegetation, the emissivity spectra is almost flat and with typically high values, higher than 0.98 or sometimes near to 1. However, in the case of dry vegetation, the spectral variation is higher and we can obtain even very low values for a given wavelength. For example, in the case of dry grass, we can obtain a low value of emissivity around 0.9. Well, we have included this example to illustrate the effect of the emissivity correction in the retrieval of the surface temperature. So let's consider two different surfaces, vegetation and a rock, marble, for example, as we have seen in the example before. In the case of vegetation, the emissivity spectrum is flat, near to one, and in the case of the marble, we can see the different spectral variations and this characteristic peak here near the 11 microns. Well, let's consider now a surface temperature of 300 Kelvin. If we apply Planck's law to this value of temperature, we obtain this curve here in red, which is the classical or the typical Planck's distribution. Well, what happens if we correct this this curve for the emissivity for the first case, for the vegetation case? Then we obtain this green curve here. In this case, the curve for or the spectral distribution for the vegetation is almost the same than the case of the Planck's law, because the emissivity spectrum is flat and near to one. However, if we do the same for the second case, for the rock, we can obtain this curve here in blue. We can observe clearly that this curve is not the same or significantly departs from the Planck's law. This is because the high spectral variation of the emissivity spectrum, especially here near the 11 microns, because of this peak in the emissivity. Well, what happens if we measure this spectral distribution with a thermal radiometer and then we invert Planck's law to recover the surface temperature? Well, in the first case, of course, we recover the initial or the original value of the surface temperature, 300 Kelvin, and this value is always the same independently of the wavelength. For the second case, for the vegetation surface, we obtain a similar value. Temperature is near to 300 and almost constant. It does not depend on the wavelength. However, in the third case, for the rock, if we invert directly the Planck's law, we obtain this temperature which depends a lot on the wavelength. We can see, for example, here in this region near the 11 microns, a difference in temperature of more than or around 10 Kelvin. So it is very important to correct for the emissivity factor to obtain an accurate value of temperature, because if not, we can obtain unrealistic values of surface temperature. In some cases, for example, vegetation or water, where the emissivity spectrum is flat and near to one, this correction is not as important as in the case of other surfaces with high variations in emissivity. But in any case, we need to perform this correction. We move now to the radiative transfer and atmospheric correction section. Well, the radiative transfer equation is the basic equation in order to develop the different land surface temperature and emissivity retrieval algorithms, as we will see in the next slides. Well, the radiative transfer equation applied to the thermal infrared region is given by this equation here. This equation can be obtained in a very intuitive manner if we consider this scheme here. So, let's consider a surface with a given temperature and a given emissivity. This surface emits radiation according to the Planck's law, including also the emissivity factor. So this term here is the emission of the surface. On the other hand, the atmosphere is also at the given temperature, so it also emits radiation, both in the upward and downward directions. In the case of the downward atmospheric radiance, this term goes to the surface and is reflected by the surface. And the reflection term can be expressed as 1 minus emissivity according to the Kirchhoff law. So these two terms here are coming from the surface. So we can call these two terms here as the at surface radiance or the land living radiance, which is this expression here. Well, before reaching the sensor, these two terms need to go through the atmosphere. Because of the absorption and scattering processes in the atmosphere, this at surface radiance needs to be corrected or multiplied by the atmospheric transmissivity, which is this term here. The atmosphere, we have said before, also emits radiance in the upward direction, which is often called as the path radiance. So the final radiance measured by the sensor is given by the path radiance and also the at surface term multiplied by the atmospheric transmissivity. The at surface radiance is given by this expression, so we can observe that this equation here is the same as this here. So we have obtained the radiative transfer equation for the thermal infrared case in just in an intuitive way, without any mathematical formalisms, but of course we can derive also this equation using a more robust classical radiative transfer theory. Well, then the signal measure by the sensor is not the radiance coming from the surface because of the perturbation of the atmosphere. The objective of the atmospheric correction is then to recover the at surface radiance from the at sensor radiance. This can be achieved in the case of thermal infrared using this simple expression. So the at surface radiance can be recovered just by subtracting the upward atmospheric radiance from the at sensor radiance, or the radiance measured by the sensor, and correcting or dividing by the atmospheric transmissivity. It should be noted that this at surface radiance also includes an atmospheric change, so we can maybe not talk about a pure atmospheric correction, because this coupling between the emissivity and the downward atmospheric radiance. Well, which are the main components or atmospheric components that contribute to the absorption of the atmosphere? Well, this is illustrated here in these two graphs. The first graph shows the atmospheric transmissivity for different wavelengths for the different or for the main atmospheric components, which is water vapor, ozone, and CO2, and also the total atmospheric transmissivity. Well, in this region between 8 and 14 microns, which is the thermal infrared region, we can observe that the total transmissivity spectrum more or less follows the same pattern than the atmospheric transmissivity for the water vapor. This implies that the main atmospheric or the main absorption in the atmosphere is due to the water vapor. There is two exceptions, one here around 9.2-9.3 microns because of the absorption of the ozone, and also between 13 or 14 microns because of the absorption of the CO2. In this graph, we show the atmospheric transmissivity, the total atmospheric transmissivity for different standard atmospheres: tropical, subarctic winter, subarctic summer, and mid-latitude winter and mid-latitude summer. Well, we can see also in this graph that the lowest atmospheric transmissivity are obtained for the case of the tropical atmosphere, because this atmosphere is very humid, so it has a high content of high atmospheric water vapor content. The highest values are obtained for the tropical, for the subarctic winter atmosphere, because this kind of atmosphere is very dry and it has a very low atmospheric water vapor content. We can clearly observe also in this graph that we have two regions with high atmospheric transmissivity. One region around here between approximately 8 and 9 microns, and another region here approximately between 10 and 12 microns. These two regions are called atmospheric windows, and they are commonly used to retrieve the land surface temperature. These two atmospheric windows are splitted or separated by this strong absorption region due to the ozone. To finish with the radiative transfer and atmospheric correction issue, we show in this graph the different terms that contribute to the radiative transfer equation, or the different terms that contribute to the final radiance measured by the sensor. Well, for a surface at a given temperature, if we apply Planck's law, we obtain this curve here. However, the radiance measured by the sensor is given by this curve here. The difference between these two curves are due to the atmospheric effect and also to the emissivity effect. So, if we want to obtain or to recover the surface temperature from the sensor radiance, we need to transform this curve here into this one. Well, which are the three contributions to the sensor measured by the radiance, as given by the radiative transfer equation? Pues the first one is the emission of the surface, which is given by the Planck's law and corrected for the emissivity and the transmissivity because of the atmospheric effect. And in general, this term is the highest term, except for the case, of course, of strong absorption regions, as this here for the ozone, or here because of the CO2, as we have seen before. The second term is the path radiance, which is represented here in red color, and typically this is lower than the emission term, except for the strong atmospheric absorption in these regions here, in which the atmospheric contribution is higher than the emission of the surface. The reflection term, here represented in blue, typically has a low contribution, however it needs also to be taken into account to obtain an accurate value of surface temperature. To finish with the most theoretical part of this tutorial, we will talk about the different temperature and emissivity retrieval techniques that we can use when working with thermal remote sensing. Well, first of all, we need to take into account which is the main problem when we want to retrieve these two parameters. We have seen before that there is a coupling between the emissivity and the downward atmospheric radiance, but the main problem is the coupling between the emissivity and the surface temperature. If we apply the radiative transfer equation to one single wavelength or one sensor band, then we obtain this expression here, and we can see that the unknowns are the surface temperature and the emissivity, if we assume that the atmospheric parameters are known. So, for a given wavelength, we have two unknowns, the temperature and the emissivity. If we apply the radiative transfer equation to other wavelengths or sensor bands, we will always have one more unknown than equations, because the emissivity is a spectral magnitude, so we have always for a given wavelength the emissivity as one unknown, but also the temperature. This means that at the end we have n equations and n plus 1 unknowns. So in terms of a mathematical system of equations, this cannot be solved. So this is the main problem when working with thermal remote sensing. And the different methods try to assume or to find an initial value for one emissivity in one wavelength or for the temperature in order to solve this problem. Well, the surface temperature retrievals from remote sensing data require an atmospheric correction and also a previous estimation of the surface emissivity in order to solve the problem that we have just commented about the coupling between temperature and emissivity. Well, rigorous algorithms for temperature and emissivity retrieval should be based on the radiative transfer equations. We can consider different kinds of classifications, but maybe the most simple or the most basic is to classify the different algorithms depending on the spectral characteristics of the thermal sensor. So in this case, the methods for land surface temperature retrieval can be classified in single channel or mono window if we only have one band, two channel or split window if we have two bands, biangular or dual angle if we have one band but two view angles, or temperature and emissivity separation algorithms if we have a multispectral configuration, at least three bands or more than three bands. Bien. In the first three cases, we need to estimate the emissivity by an independent mean. We need to know a priori the emissivity. However, in this last case, we obtain simultaneously the temperature and the emissivity, so we do not require a priori knowledge of the emissivity. Well, this is a basic classification. You can find more details about the different algorithms for both temperature and emissivity retrieval in these two references. For the case of the single channel algorithm using one thermal band, the most accurate or rigorous approach is just an inversion of the radiative transfer equation, which is expressed here in this equation. If we want to obtain temperature using this single channel approach, we need as input data the emissivity, but also the different atmospheric parameters. These atmospheric parameters can be obtained from atmospheric profiles and a radiative transfer code. We have different sources of atmospheric profiles, for example, radio soundings or reanalysis, satellite products, etc. And we have also different radiative transfer models available. For the case of the Landsat series, we have also a web-based interface, which is the Atmospheric Correction Parameter Calculator, which is available here in this link, which provide these atmospheric parameters for the case of the Landsat sensors. Well, in order to simplify this expression here, different single-channel algorithms have been developed, and also they tend to minimize the input data. For example, in the case of the generalized single-channel algorithm that can be applied to any thermal band, we have this expression here, and these atmospheric functions depend only on the atmospheric water vapor in order to simplify or to minimize the input data. This algorithm has been also applied to the Landsat series in order to obtain consistent land surface temperature products from the sensors on board the Landsat series. Well, in the case of the two-channel algorithms or the split window technique, it is based on the differential absorption concept. Well, the basis of the differential absorption is that we can perform the atmospheric correction from the difference in brightness temperature or the difference in radiance into different thermal bands. Based on this concept, different mathematical expressions have been proposed in the literature, but maybe one of the, or just as an example, we propose here this mathematical expression. According to this expression, the surface temperature can be obtained from the brightness temperature at one thermal band and corrected for the atmospheric effect using this differential absorption concept. We can also consider other terms that takes into account the emissivity correction in order to improve the surface temperature retrieval. This same mathematical expression can be applied to the case of one band but two view angles, which is the dual angle technique. In this case, instead of using two bands, we use one view angle at nadir and another view angle forward or oblique in general. The problems of this method are related to the different footprints for nadir and forward views, and also the possible temperature and emissivity angular dependencies. Well, in order to apply the previous methods, single channel or split window algorithms, we need a priori knowledge of the emissivity. Or in other words, we need to obtain the emissivity by an independent way. In these cases, because we have only one or two bands, the most common approach is to obtain the emissivity using visible near-infrared data, or for example, a vegetation index such as the NDVI. We have different methods, for example, the vegetation cover method or the NDVI thresholds method, in which the emissivity, the effective emissivity, is obtained from soil and vegetation emissivities using the fractional vegetation cover or proportion of vegetation as a weight factor. And also, we take into account the different internal reflections or the cavity effect using, or by adding this term here, we can be obtained in a theoretical way using a geometrical model. In the case of the NDVI thresholds method, the pixels are previously classified into three different classes: bare pixels, mixed pixels, or fully vegetated pixels, depending on the NDVI value. So in this way, we can obtain the emissivity using, for example, the NDVI, and then use this emissivity as input to the single channel or split window algorithms to recover the surface temperature. Well, another approach is to obtain an emissivity maps by other means is to use a classification or land cover. In this case, an emissivity value is assigned to each class or land cover. Here we show some examples in which, from using a land cover map, we can finally obtain the emissivity map. The higher the resolution of the land cover map, then the higher resolution will have the final emissivity product. It is important to remark that the surface emissivity depends on the observation angle, among other factors. This is especially critical for the case of the dual angle technique for land surface temperature retrieval, because we need to know the emissivity not only at nadir but also at a given angle, typically around 50 degrees. For the case of the emissivity over land, the angular characterization is not easy because of the heterogeneity of the surface and also the rugosity, but in any case we can use different instruments, for example a goniometer system, to identify or to characterize the angular variation of the different surfaces, different land surfaces. In the case of the sea surface emissivity, it depends mainly on the observation angle and the wind speed, because this is typically a more homogeneous surface than the case of land surfaces. The angular variation for sea can be modelized using different available models, but also can be obtained from using simple models, for example this one here, in which the emissivity, the sea surface emissivity for a given angle can be obtained from the nadir value and the wind speed here. You can find more details in this reference. Well, the other approach for temperature and emissivity retrieval, if we have a multispectral sensor with at least three bands, is the temperature and emissivity separation. This method is composed of three different modules, the NEM, the ratio, and the MD or spectral contrast. In the first module, we obtain a first guess for the surface emissivities and temperature using an iterative procedure from an initial value of the emissivity. In the ratio module, this first guess of surface emissivities are normalized in order to minimize the errors due to, for example, the noise of the sensor. And finally, in the last module, this MMD module, which is the key module of the method, will recover the actual values of surface temperature and emissivities for the different sensor bands. You can find a very detailed description of the algorithm in this reference here. The important or the main idea behind this method is that we retrieve simultaneously land surface temperature and emissivity from the thermal data, so we don't need to use visible and near-infrared data or to use the other approaches with vegetation index, etc. This method was originally developed for Aster sensor, but it can be adapted to any sensor with at least three bands. It has recovered a special interest in these last years because this method has been applied to MODIS data to obtain a new MODIS product or surface temperature and emissivity, and it has been also applied to the SEVIRI on board the Meteosat second generation to provide also a new product of surface temperature and emissivity. In the case of MODIS, this product will be available for the different users, and in the case of the SEVIRI, it's just a kind of a prototype, is not operative at this moment. Here we show some examples of these two approaches. For the case of MODIS, we can observe a significant difference between the new product and the original MODIS product, and we can observe also that this new product follows the phenological behavior of different surfaces. This is the case of the SEVIRI, and we can observe also that, for example, the temperature and emissivity separation algorithms reflects more the variations in emissivity, or the spatial pattern is more consistent than classification-based approaches or other existing products, as for example the MODIS standard product. Well, in order to finish this first part of the tutorial, we would like to comment some issues related to the measurements in the thermal infrared region. These measurements can be carried out at different levels using airborne sensors or using sensors on board satellites, and also using sensors at ground level. Well, in the case of airborne sensors, we show here some examples of different available sensors that can be mounted on board different planes and then to perform different flights to obtain different thermal imagery at very high spatial resolution because of the low altitude of the flights compared to the altitude of sensors on board satellites. We have, for example, the AHS, which has been used in many field campaigns organized by the European Space Agency, and other examples of hyperspectral sensors, airborne sensors in the thermal infrared, which allows the retrieval of a very complete emissivity spectra. Emissivity spectra with a very spectral, a very high spectral resolution. In the case of satellite sensors, we can distinguish between high-resolution sensors or low-resolution sensors in terms of the spatial resolution. For the case of high spatial resolution, we have only the Landsat series, and especially we can remark or highlight the Ascend sensor, which has 5 bands in the thermal infrared. It is the only sensor currently with these characteristics, with providing multispectral thermal data. We have also the Sievers series, similar to the Landsat case, but we can say that in terms of higher resolution, there is a necessity for another sensor to continue with the Landsat series and also with the Aster initiative. In terms of low spatial resolution, things are much better. We have a variety of sensors currently providing operational measurements, both in terms of polar orbiting sensors or geostationary sensors. You can find a very complete list of sensors here in this link. Regarding the measurements at the ground level or the in situ measurements, they can be carried out by transects, measuring while walking, or also using fixed masts or towers in order to provide continuous measurements over a fixed point. Temperature measurements can be performed by emission, and then we will need to solve the coupling between temperature and emissivity. We have seen or commented before this problem. And also we can measure the temperature by contact, but in this case the concept of temperature is not the same, because one is the radiometric temperature or skin temperature measured by emission, and by contact we will talk more of a thermodynamic temperature. In the case of emissivity, we can measure the emissivity by emission, and we will have the same problem, the coupling between temperature and emissivity, but also by reflection using the Kirchhoff law. This is the typical approach to measure the emissivity in the laboratory, and all these emissivity spectra included in the spectral libraries are measured by reflection. Well, we have different instruments to measure temperature or emissivity and ground level. This is just an example of a few instruments. We have thermal radiometers to measure brightness temperature. These ones here are broadband, they have only one band, but we have also different thermal radiometers with different bands. These are multiband radiometers. It is very important to calibrate the radiometers, so we have the calibration sources, and it is also important to characterize the downwelling atmospheric radiance in order to correct the reflection term and obtain accurate values of temperature. This can be made using this diffuse plate. We have other instrumentation, for example, a box for emissivity measurements, also thermal cameras in order to analyze the spatial pattern of the field of view of the radiometer, and also goniometers in order to perform the angular measurements of both temperature or emissivity. Well, in terms of protocols to perform the in situ measurements, there is an initiative which is the Working Group on Calibration and Validation, and in particular the Land Product Validation Subgroup, in which the land surface and emissivity has an important role in this subgroup. And one of the main objectives of these groups are to define protocols for both the validation, collection, and identify existing sites in terms of temperature and emissivity. You can find the details here in this link, and also you will find different references related to the protocols in order to make the different measurements of by different research groups intercomparable among others. Well, if we want to perform measurements, in situ measurements by emission, then we can use the radiative transfer equation, but in this case, because the sensor is located almost at the ground level, the atmospheric contribution is negligible. So the atmospheric transmissivity is near one, and the upward atmospheric radiance, or the path radiance, is almost zero. So in this case, the radiative transfer equation can be simplified to this expression here. If we want to obtain or to recover the temperature, then we need to know previously the emissivity. And if we want to obtain the emissivity, we need to know previously the temperature. This is because of the problem of the coupling between the emissivity and temperature. So, for example, in this case, if we want to measure at the ground level the temperature, we need to know or to measure or to estimate a priori the surface emissivity. This can be done using, for example, an independent method for measuring the emissivity. For example, the box method. The box method allows the retrieval of the surface emissivity from radiance measurements collected with the radiometer, and it solves the coupling between emissivity and temperature. For example, this is a box for emissivity measurements with a hot and cold leads. There is also other versions of the box method. But in this case, we can obtain the emissivity from the radiance of the hot lead, the radiance of the sample with the cold lead, and the radiance of the sample with the hot lead, using this expression here. So we don't need to know the surface temperature to obtain the emissivity. This is the advantage of this method. The measurements with the hot and cold lead should be simultaneous, and an emissivity equals zero, or a reflectivity equal one, is assumed for the walls of the box. There is another option if we have a multiband radiometer. Despite that the test algorithm was developed from ASTER, an instrument on board a satellite, it can be also applied to in situ measurements. So, in this case, we can obtain simultaneously both the surface temperature and the emissivity, which is the main advantage of the test method. Well, we move now to the second part of the tutorial, in which we will show briefly some examples of applications. Well, the first application refers to the calibration and validation. Maybe this is not really an application, but we have included in this part of the tutorial because we will show some real cases or case studies, results obtained in different field campaigns. Why is important the calibration and validation? It's because the increased availability of global satellite sensor data is resulting in an increase in satellite sensor products for global change research and environmental monitoring. The ensuing research and policy directive that will utilize these satellite products for different reasons puts a high priority on provided statements on their accuracy. Bien, validation refers to the process of quantifying the accuracy of the geophysical products derived from the remote sensing data, whereas calibration refers to the process of quantitatively defining the system response to known control signal inputs. You can find a more detailed definition here in this reference. Well, this is an example of a calibration and validation exercise in the framework of a field campaign organized by the European Space Agency in the region of Barrats, which is an agricultural area in Spain. Bien, during the field campaigns, a complete dataset of field measurements and airborne sensors, also satellite images, can be acquired. These databases allow the calibration of different sensors and also the development of algorithms and the validation of the product derived from the different algorithms. Bien, this graph here shows an example of the of analysis of the calibration of the airborne sensor. In red is the curve for the different bands, thermal bands of the sensor, the values reproduced from the in-situ measurements, whereas the curve in blue represents the values extracted directly from the sensor data. Of course, if the sensor is well calibrated, these two curves should be similar. They will show only a minor difference because of the uncertainty involved in the in-situ measurements. So we can observe here in this case, which refers to a value or to measurements carried out in a water body, which is very homogeneous and it can be used for calibration purposes, that both curves are very similar, so this shows that the sensor is well calibrated. Since we have a complete database of both airborne imagery and also in-situ measurements, we can apply different algorithms for surface temperature retrieval and to perform an intercomparison between these different algorithms in order to extract conclusions about the performance of the different techniques. We can see in this case that both the split window approach or single channel algorithms or the test algorithm provided satisfactory results. We can do something similar in terms of satellite sensors, and here we show just some examples of calibration of different sensors on board satellites, for example MODIS, AATSR, SEVIRI, or the Landsat case. You can find different publications here in this link with different results obtained in different field campaigns regarding these calibration and validation exercises. Well, another important application refers to the evapotranspiration retrieval using thermal data. Evapotranspiration refers to the water loss from the soil surface, which is the evaporation, and from the crop, which is the transpiration. The knowledge of the evapotranspiration allows the irrigation water use optimization, and it's important for the hydrological cycle. The direct estimation of evapotranspiration by solving the energy Boolean equation requires thermal data, and this is an important thing. Well, we have different models to retrieve the heat fluxes and the evapotranspiration. Here we show an example of those of two models. The first one, which is the SEVI, is a simplified model. We can allow the retrieval of evapotranspiration using just the analysis of the graph between the surface temperature and the albedo or the NDVI. As I said, it's a simplified model and it can be used to obtain evapotranspiration mainly for high resolution data because we need that the atmospheric conditions over the image remain constant. Another more physically based model is the TESEP model. It's a two-source model, and it also allows the recovery of the heat fluxes and evapotranspiration. You can find more details about the models and some examples of applications here in these two references. This is just to show the final evapotranspiration maps obtained from the SEBI model, in this case, from using airborne data, also in the Barracks area in Spain, from using airborne imagery, or in the case of the TSEP approach using Landsat data. This is another example of heat fluxes or evapotranspiration retrieval using the TSEF methodology and Landsat data over the Basilicata region in Italy. This is to demonstrate that we can also obtain maps at the regional level of evapotranspiration. Well, thermal remote sensing can be also used for water stress detection, as for example this case in which we used thermal imagery to detect water stress in an olive orchard. Well, what we observe is that using in-situ measurements over the crown of the olive trees, the temperature or the difference between the temperature for stress olive trees and well-irrigated olive trees is around 4 Kelvin. This difference can be detected using thermal imagery, so at the end we can obtain maps over all the olive orchard in order to detect which regions are affected by or are stressed and there are deficit irrigation treatment. You can find a complete description of this application here in this reference. Well, another important application refers to the urban heat island. This is an example of the evaluation of this effect in the city of Madrid using thermal remote sensing that was acquired in the framework of the DESIREX campaign organized by the European Space Agency. Here we show two land surface temperature maps, one at noon and the other one at night. And at noon we can observe that the surroundings are more or less colder than the or warmer than the center of the city. However, in the case of the nighttime acquisition, the center of the city is warmer than the surroundings, which is the effect known as the urban heat island. Bien, using this imagery, we can derive different indexes, for example, the discomfort index, in which we assign different classes depending on the value of the index, in order to obtain, for example, the very cold, cool, or comfortable classes. This is an example of a map of the discomfort index for the case of the city of Madrid. Well, another application which requires thermal infrared data refers to the analysis or detection and prediction of extreme temperatures. These applications usually require measurements of air temperature. However, from thermal remote sensing, we cannot obtain directly the air temperature but the surface temperature. Well, the relationship between air temperature and surface temperature is a difficult task because it depends on many factors. However, different approaches have been developed in order to derive the air temperature from measurements of land surface temperature. Here we provide some examples for daytime and nighttime using as input the surface temperature and other parameters, for example, a vegetation index, the NDVI, and geographical and meteorological data, for example, the latitude, distance, or relative humidity, etc. This approach has been applied, for example, to the Valencian community, here using MODIS data. The coefficients of these equations need to be particularized for other regions because the relationship between air temperature and surface temperature is not universal. So, for any region, we need to obtain specific coefficients. This is another example of an application related to the extreme temperatures, in this case for drought detection or drought monitoring over the Amazon forest. These are some examples of anomalies in terms of land surface temperature for the dry season in 2 years, 2005 and 2010, where two severe droughts occurred. This methodology is currently implemented in a web-based interface, and you can find the details and also this kind of maps here in this link. And the last application we want to show in this part refers to environmental pollution, and in particular to the oil slick identification. Well, using measurements in the laboratory, it was observed that the angular variation of the water is lower than the angular variation of the crude, especially at high view angles. So this result was applied to a real case, which was the oil slick identification for the case of the BP Deepwater Horizon platform, this natural disaster in 2010. For this purpose, ASTER images and ATSR images were used. The use of the ATSR is because it has two view angles, so we can recover the emissivity of the seawater and also the crude at a given view angle, in this case around 55 degrees. So using this methodology here, we are not going into details, you can consult this reference here, it was possible to obtain a map in which the oil slick was clearly delimited and identified. Using this result, that the emissivity, the angular emissivity of the crude is higher than the emissivity of the sea water. And well, that's all. Apart from the reference included in the different slides, here we provide some basic textbooks. The first two are in Spanish, and the other two are in English and specifically dedicated to thermal infrared remote sensing. Thank you for your attention, and we hope that this tutorial is interesting for you. Thanks.